How far will Beta Ray Bill be willing to go if it means reclaiming his old powers? Well, let's hop into the pages of Beta Ray Bill issue number 2 and find out together, shall we? So then, picking up from where the last issue left off, poor Bill found himself emasculated, eviscerated, and completely and utterly unappreciated by people he found to be his closest friends and allies. For all those reasons and more, Bill has decided to hit the cosmic road to try and get back his Stormbreaker powers. It's not gonna be easy as Bill is forced to hunt down the ever-elusive Odin, the former King of Asgard, and just as he thinks he's ready to make some progress, his ship's scuttlebutt ends up getting boarded. And you can very much tell that the guy writing this book is the same guy drawing this book, because we're treated to an absolutely amazing panel wherein we see every room inside Bill's ship. Luckily for our hero, the boarding party in this situation is friend and not foe. It's Scourge, everybody, longtime Thor family villain and occasional Thor family ally, like in this situation. Scourge was dead previously, but don't feel too bad, he got better, and he says, well, in the halls of Valhalla, he actually managed to see Beta Ray Bill getting rejected by Sif in a scene that completely broke his heart as much as it broke the reader's. Naturally, Bill is pretty damn horrified that maybe the most embarrassing, dejecting moment of his entire personal life is the fodder for the dead, but hey, here you have it. Scourge is on the case, and he says that he's going to be joining Bill as his own personal wingman. Scourge is never one to take no for an answer, though, and if nothing else, he does actually seem to have a lead as to where Odin is hanging his head these days, a rather disgusting little alien bar wherein you'll never find a more wretched hive of scum and villainy. Naturally, our motley crew isn't there for more than a few minutes when they end up coming under attack by a bunch of space bikers who end up causing a huge bar fight. Bill, who I truly appreciate went casual on this mission, almost gets himself cut by one of the nasty customers, only for him to be saved by Pip the space troll who followed him from Asgard. Yes, despite everything that's happened and all the respect that Bill hasn't been getting, Pip is still very much the number one Beta Ray Bill fan, and once he saw him leave Asgard in a huff, decided to follow him. Which again, when Pip is the only one in the universe who seems to love and appreciate you, that sort of thing ends up having the opposite effect for some reason. Ultimately, our ever more motley growing crew ends up coming face to face with Odin, who was in the back brewing his own beer. Yeah, the former King of Asgard is in a bit of a cosmic midlife crisis at the moment, which ends up making him more than just a little sympathetic about Beta Ray Bill's plight right now. The only problem is, even if he did get the dwarves of space to forge a new Stormbreaker hammer for Beta Ray Bill, it wouldn't be the same. The hammer's just a hammer. It's the old Odin magic that made it what it was. And unfortunately, old One-Eye is a broken-down warhorse who can't do much of anything right now besides grouse and drink, which is no good for Beta Ray Bill. He does, however, know one alternative, but he's not gonna like it. For you see, deep in the fires of Muspelheim lays the Twilight Blade, once the signature weapon of the fire giant Surtur. A weapon that Beta Ray Bill knows all too well, as Surtur had destroyed his home planet in hopes of using the embers to fuel his weapon. Surtur's daughter Cinder now rules in Muspelheim, but for whatever reason, she is either unwilling or unable to lift the Twilight Blade for herself. And so Beta Ray Bill's path is clear. He must go to the Fire Realm and must lift this ancient blade for himself to take its power. Granted, doing so ends up stirring up all sorts of feelings inside Bill, as if he needed that already. Bill both remembers the destruction of his planet and his race and how he never really dealt with those feelings because he just kind of went from one adventure to another once he ended up getting involved with the Thor cast and, you know, getting Stormbreaker for himself. Furthermore, despite a lifetime of hanging out with gods and heroes, Beta Ray Bill is himself very much mortal, and there's a good chance that if he takes this journey, he's not going to be making it back in one piece. And you know what? When it rains, it pours, because as Beta Ray Bill finds out from the elite Asgardian guards standing watch over the Stygian Gate into Muspelheim, even the few people who do actually manage to make it back from Muspelheim, a lot of them end up completely changed, horrifying zombies dark in the eyes who need to be destroyed lest that corruption spread to the rest of the universe. Now, being a good upstanding gentleman, Bill says that this is as good a time as any for him to part ways with Scourge and Pip. Only here's the problem, these guys are in it to win it. They're here for the long haul and they're going to accompany Bill to the other side. Pip does an especially good job explaining why, saying, hey, you think you're the only one who suffers with image problems? You think you're the only one who wishes their lives were a little different? Well, maybe this is my way of dealing with that, too. I mean, come on, man, I'm called Pip the Troll. How do you think that messes with my mind every single day? And thus, the Fellowship of the Twilight Blade is formed, ready to risk it all to see what's on the other side. Only, here's the thing, the team ends up growing a little bit bigger, too, as they pass through the portal. You see, here's the crazy thing, as Scuttlebutt ends up passing through the portal, the ship, well, becomes a person. A lady person, as the comic comes to a close. And so that was Beta Ray Bill issue number 2, everybody, and if you can believe it, this second issue I think was even better than the first one. In fact, if this series can keep up this momentum, it's gonna end up being my favorite miniseries of the year. Daniel Warren Johnson is really starting to prove himself as a master of creating sympathy, not just for Beta Ray Bill, but for all these other characters who are considered one-note jokes. This issue deals with a lot of interesting ideas that I don't see comics tackle all that much. Image, self-worth, self-determination, and honestly, the kind of line between when healthy masculinity becomes unhealthy masculinity and vice versa. I'd give this one another very well-deserved 9 out of 10. Very, very good stuff.
Hey there, everyone. It's your old pal Cape Jewel again, thanking you so much for watching to the end of the video. I hope you enjoyed it, and if you did, why not check out my Amazon link down in the description? Yes, that's right. The Cape Jewel channel officially has its own Amazon storefront now. You can pick up a comic or anything else for that matter, and if you did, you'd really be helping me and the channel. So with that out of the way, everyone, I will see you again next time. Bye-bye.